Hello and greetings from Bronx, New York. This is Ronald Wharton. I'm a cardiologist at Montefiore Medical Center and the Albert Einstein College of Medicine. And today I thought I'd present something which I think you'll find educational and somewhat amusing. I titled this, Is the Problem the Pill? Or Is There a Pill for This Problem? So here's the history. This is a 45-year-old gentleman who was admitted to the inpatient service. He came in because of shortness of breath. His history is that he had been told in the past of a very high LDL and high triglycerides. He was started on a high-potency statin. He's not taking any other medications. He comes to the emergency room because he just feels fatigued. It's getting worse. He's getting more and more short of breath. Here's some pertinent things on his labs. His physical exam wasn't particularly revealing other than the fact that he's obese. He had a standard cardiac troponin T, which came back at 0.15 nanograms per milliliter. The reference in our lab is less than 0.11. He also had a very high total CK, almost 14,000. The CKMB was 0.6% of the total CK. His transaminases were also elevated, and he was admitted to telemetry. So is there something wrong with his heart? Is this all a case of statin-induced myositis and statin-induced hepatitis? Well, everybody gets an echocardiogram nowadays, and this gentleman is no exception. You can see here, here's a parasternal long axis 2D image, and in this image, you can see the LV systolic function is good, the RV systolic function looks good, and if you look closely, there's some early diastolic collapse of the RV free wall. In the next slide, you can see a similar thing. This is now parasternal short axis at the level of the aortic valve, and again, you can see that there is some early diastolic collapse of the free wall of the right ventricular outflow tract. You can see these findings on M-mode. So here we have an M-mode through the aortic valve, and you'll notice that after the aortic valve closes, the tricuspid valve should be opening up and the RV should be getting bigger, but there is a bit of a delay between when the aortic valve closes and when the RVOT starts expanding. In the next slide, you can see something similar in the mitral M mode. You'll notice that after the mitral valve opens, there's a bit of a delay before the RVOT starts to get bigger. So there are both 2D and confirmatory M mode findings demonstrating tamponade physiology. Take a look for a second at this apical four-chamber view. You can see that there is a circumferential pericardial effusion. The function of the RV and the LV appear to be normal. And similarly, if you look at the two-chamber view on the next slide, you can see that the anterior and inferior walls appear to thicken normally, and again, note the circumferential pericardial effusion. The next slide demonstrates a pulse wave Doppler through the mitral valve, and you'll notice that there is significant respiratory variation in the mitral inflow, depending on whether the patient is taking a deep breath in or a deep breath out. During inspiration, the mitral velocities are reduced. During expiration, the mitral velocities are higher. So here's some questions. Is there a regional abnormality? It doesn't seem to be. The wall thickening in all the views that I showed you, the parasternal long axis, the apical four, and the apical two-chamber views all looked okay. So certainly no echo evidence of any previous infarction. Is there tamponade physiology? Well, we covered that. You can see it in the imaging very clearly, and if you don't, you can also look at the M-mode images, which give you the additional time resolution, demonstrating that the RVOT starts to expand considerably after the aortic valve is closed and after the mitral valve has opened. You can see those again, just so I'll show you the M-mode again. Take a look at where the aortic valve is closing, see where the RVOT starts to come up. And again, in the mitral valve, you'll notice that the mitral valve always opens probably a good 100 or more. I didn't measure it on the slides, but that's probably at least 100 milliseconds before the RV starts to get bigger. So what do we do? He's on a statin. That's all he's taking. His CKs are off the wall. His transaminases are high. He has evidence of pericardial tamponade physiology with a moderate circumferential pericardial effusion. You can probably guess that that effusion didn't get there overnight from its size, because considering its size, these findings of tamponade are pleasant, but they're not certainly the worst case we've ever seen on an echocardiogram. Do we stop the statin? Do we do a paracoxanthesis? Do we do both? Do we do neither? Well, one other thing to think about, should we look at a imaging study, look at constriction? Is this constrictive pericarditis? Maybe the statin has nothing to do with it. After all, he has a pericardial effusion. Maybe that's part of some inflammatory process involving the pericardium, and he has constricted physiology. There is ventricular interdependence. You saw that very clearly on the pulsatile Doppler through the mitral valve, as well as the 2D and M mode imaging, and his liver functions are abnormal. That's how constriction presents, isn't it? So maybe this is all constriction. Well, that's a great thought, but there's only one problem. Did you notice through all of those images, despite the tamponade physiology, that his heart rate's only about 60 beats per minute? He's not taking a beta blocker, he's just taking a statin. So what's the answer? Drum roll. Well, what did we do? Did we do a pericardiocentesis? Did we do a liver biopsy? Or did we just do a blood test? It was a blood test. Patient's TSH was also 400 micrograms per cc. So if you look at the next slide, and with my apologies to Dr. Seuss, there is no statin hepatitis. There is no statin myositis. The statin here is not to blame. The thyroid here is not so tame. The thyroid here is, what is sick? This is the answer to my trick. And finally, here is the thrill of what can happen with a pill. That is if the pill is levothyroxine. Here's a repeat echocardiogram 8 months later. The patient did not have any procedures. No needles were stuck anywhere. Here's a parasternal long axis. Same patient. No effusion. Apical four chamber in the next slide. Normal LV, normal RV. No effusion. So in summary, the myositis is gone, the liver is better, and the pericardium is finally no longer wetter. I won't quit my day job just yet. But I hope you enjoyed this, a nice case of thyroid disease causing all of these other problems. My appreciation to my colleagues in the Division of Endocrinology at Montefiore for sharing the case with me. Hope you liked it. This is Ronald Wharton at Albert Einstein College of Medicine, Montefiore Medical Center in the Bronx, New York, on behalf of theheart.org at Medscape. Hope you liked it.